Hello, Darklings. This is Linnie, and welcome to our very first episode of Season 4 of Honey Radio. We're sorry we've been off the airwaves for so long, but we're stoked to be back, and we're especially excited that, for our first episode of 2017, we got to welcome Ethan Embry back to the podcast. The star of the soon-to-be-released The Devil's Candy, coming out March 17th, chatted with musical horror honey Brittany and I about his new film, his history with metal, and his feels about a certain Oscar nominee.
Greetings from Tromaville. This is Lloyd Kaufman, president of Troma Entertainment and creator of the Toxic Avenger. And you know, when we're not making those great movies like Tromeo and Juliet and the Toxic Avenger, the Troma team and I like to kick back and we like to hang out at Horror Honeys because Horror Honeys gives us everything we could possibly want, not just in the world of cinema and horror, but in the world of wisdom and philosophy. Thank you.
Hello, hello, hello.
Hi, Ethan. How are you?
I'm good. How are you guys doing?
Good, thanks. This is Linnie from the Horror Honeys and Belladonna. And
hey, Lenny and Belladonna.
And of course, there's a helicopter flying over for some reason.
I'm just turning my CNN down, pulling myself away from trending Twitter topics for a minute.
Good.
You saved me.
This is why I got rid of cable. I couldn't take it anymore.
Yeah, I don't have cable, but now I just stream it online like an idiot.
Yeah, I find that giving myself a break occasionally actually helps.
Yeah.
It's the only way to survive.
Yeah, I probably should.
I also have...
How are you guys doing tonight?
Good. I have Brittany.
Oh, we got
me.
More. We got
yes.
More.
Yes, hey. I have Brittany with me, who is... she covers all of our music and horror-related things that are musical-related, so...
This is kind of a double whammy.
Yeah, this was in her wheelhouse. So she's gonna kind of be covering everything. I'm here to hang out and be creepy and listen.
Nice. All right.
That's what I do best.
That sounds fun.
So, jump right in.
Did you guys get to see the movie? Did you get to see it?
Yes.
They send it to you?
Yes.
Oh, good.
I tweeted good out thing. After I watched it that, I loved it. I thought it was amazing.
Nice.
Yeah, I got a message right after she watched it that was like, if you love metal as much as you say you do, you need to watch this movie right now. And I was like, okay.
It's pretty metal, ain't it?
I like it.
Yeah, it's pretty damn metal. Yeah, they did good.
Brittany, you wanna start asking stuff?
Sure. So we can kind of jump in, just you know, in regards to you know metal and how much the music plays a prominent part in the film. What about it do you think is so crucial to telling the story, and why there was such a big focus on it, both as you know characters and part of the soundtrack?
I think it comes. It probably starts with Sean Byrne, the writer director, with his love for it, and also just how cinematic it can be and how much power it can add to visuals. The sound of metal, man, it's, I don't know why more filmmakers don't use it, because it's so powerful. I think he did this too. Sean did it with The Loved Ones, his first film, where the characters have this attraction to metal, but they're not stereotypes, they're not characters or satired at all. It's not the airheads, the metalheads, you know?
Yeah.
He just plays them like normal dudes, because that's the vast majority of us. That's how we are. I mean, there's a couple of us at the shows that may have had too much rubber cement in their early teens, but for the most part, we're productive members of society.
Hopefully.
Yeah. And I guess that the genre of music has had a long relationship with the fallen angels, with the darker side of religion. I don't know, it's just horror movies and metal. It's just kind of a perfect mashup, especially when it's a horror movie about the devil.
Totally. So speaking of, you kind of already touched on my next question about metal fans are, and people who are into that type of music are often referred to as we're devil worshippers, we're Satanists, just because we like the type of music. So in developing your character, how did you try to change that perception of that to being a more complete and holistic character and person?
I wanted the main thing of the movie, I wanted it to be a story about a family, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I thought, from the beginning, I always thought the most important aspect for me was to convey this family unit that people could look at and either identify or idolize, you know? Like, that's the family unit I want to have, or that's the family unit that I created.
Mm-hmm.
And so some way you create a unit that is familiar to people, identifiable. I grew up going to shows, and I grew up listening to it myself. I'm a goofball, man.
What bands are you into now? I'm just totally curious now. I'm a big fan of the genre too, obviously. So
I'm still stuck in the ones that I met when I was young, the old hardcore bands like Turmoil, and then the foreign metal bands like Meshuga, like early Sepultura. It's not necessarily metal, but Rage Against the Machine is around a lot for me. I just got turned on to a new band. I guess it's actually not a new band. It's also an older band, but Chiodos. Have you heard of them?
Yep.
I think, am I pronouncing that right? Chiodos?
I think so. Yeah, depends on who you ask.
90s metal. And he loved it when he was young, and now he's into like trap music and shit. So I don't have the youth showing me what's going on these days, and I now live out in the suburbs. So I'm an old man stuck in my ways. I go to the coffee shop and I order the same omelet every day. I listen to the same metal every day. That's what happens when you get old. But what is it? Death Driver? Is that the name of it?
Devil Driver or Winds of Plague is like my favorite of all time. And they're very dark, but they have a really big symphonic element to their sounds. And they're like, they're
nice
to listen to. Yeah, totally.
I got in for the, when we were shooting, I had, as far as symphonic sounds go, I had Death Haven and the Swans playing nonstop in my room. I just put it on, and as soon as I would get in, that shit's dark.
Yeah. Oh, I love it.
I still keep up. It's not really, again, it's not really metal, but like I keep up when Mogwai comes out with new shit. Have you ever gotten into Mogwai?
I haven't.
They're so great.
How do you spell it?
I think they're... M-O-G-W-A-I, maybe?
Yeah.
Okay.
That was my high school years.
Yeah, and they still come out with shit. They still drop a vinyl, like, every other year. They go from melodic to metal, back and forth. It's not death metal, that's for sure. It's a lot more along the lines of that, just like symphonic soundscape.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I know that metal is really, it has its like the bands like Death Driver and what was the other one that you said? Swirling Plague or something?
Wind Plague.
Yes. Like they sound like they fall into like the definite metal category. And then
right.
People would get so pissed off when I would call Turmoil or Dillinger Escape Plan just as the blanket metal, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, no, that's hardcore, man.
People get so caught up in like the subgenres of like that's thrash,
yeah,
deathcore, and like you need to calm down. Like it's all good.
There's so many of them. There's right? That's mathematics Satan chant, dude.
It's okay to like
so all many. Yeah, just like heavy shit.
Yeah. Have you seen the movie Deathgasm by chance?
No, I gotta see that too. People have been bringing that up. That I think was at Fantastic Fest last year, but I didn't get a chance to see it. And people have been bringing it up, like comparing it to Devil's Candy in the sense, in the metal sense. But I need to see it. I gotta check it out.
Yeah, no, totally. It's completely different. Like, it's definitely like one of those like campy horror comedy movies that like focuses on you know, metal bringing about like this zombie-like apocalypse to a town because it's like the darkest, blackest metal ever, and it's hilarious.
Yes.
It's awesome.
Yes.
I totally recommend it.
That kind of reminds me a little bit of in the vein of like Evil Dead.
Totally, except like it's not taking itself too seriously. Like it's funny. It's like by the time you get to Army of Darkness, funny at that point.
Yes.
Totally.
Yes. I'm into it.
Go watch it after this is done. No more CNN.
Can we find it? Is it out and about?
I think it's on Amazon Instant Video still. I'm
oh,
not,
dope.
It was
yeah,
on Netflix.
I'm on it.
Is it still on Netflix? It was.
I don't remember if it's still on Netflix.
I can look.
I'm on it. I'll find it. It's out there. It's in the world of VOD.
Oh, totally. Yeah.
It's not hard to find. All right,
good. I still haven't even seen Hardcore Henry or Hardcore Hank or whatever. I still haven't seen that one.
I hear that one made a lot of people sick with the motion sickness.
Yeah, the way that they shot it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, well, I'm gonna go off on a tangent a little bit, but so last summer at Fantastic Fest, they had the virtual reality booths set up. There were three different short films shot in virtual reality. And now there's an app that you can go and you can watch them. And they look pretty good on your phone. But it was my first virtual reality experience. And one of them is called The Mule. Have you heard of this thing?
Mm-mm.
Yes. I've heard of it. I have not experienced it yet. I've seen people talking about it.
It's so rad. It's so dope. And it made me think of Hardcore. Is it Hank or Henry? It's Hardcore Henry, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. If they, because the only thing, those three virtual reality shorts, the character that the viewer was, you know, you're sitting there and you're a character in it and you can look around spherically. It's not even 360. It's up, down, all around. But each of those three characters didn't move. So there must be something in the technology that's limiting them from being able to move that camera. Like as if the character was walking or getting in a car and moving around.
Right.
When they figure out how to do that, horror movies are going to be so insane.
Isn't there already one that's set at... Linnie, you probably know better than I do, that set, like, virtual reality style?
An actual movie?
Yeah, that was shot virtual reality. I'm sure that exists.
You know what? Come to think of it, I think Harrison Smith just did something with Amanda Wiss that was a VR horror movie. I can't remember what it was called, though. I would have to look into it.
By the time that evolves, though, that's going to be so intense.
Yeah, when they can actually... Like if you had Hardcore Henry, but instead of to look where they were looking, if you had full control over which part of it you wanted to see, it would be, it's a whole new type of filmmaking too, because you do it like a play.
Right.
There's no two shots. There's no coverage. There's no editing. It's all done in a one-er, and it's nonstop unless you have cut points.
Yeah.
Are you a gamer? Do you play video games?
No. I used to. I used to a lot, and then I saw on Final Fantasy, like one of the old Final Fantasies, you could go in the settings and see how long you've been playing it. And I was just disgusted with myself. I was just disgusted.
Well, not to encourage breaking your rehabilitation, but there is a game called Until Dawn that recreates the experience of being in a horror film, and it's more making decisions and seeing how they play out. Yeah, it's really I mean, besides being beautiful, it's really interesting. It's all based on the butterfly effect.
What's the name of it again?
Until Dawn.
Until Dawn.
Yeah.
Okay. We've got that Xbox action, so maybe we can download it on there.
I think.
All right, I'm gonna look for it.
It might be PS4 only. I might be making that up. But I think it's PS4 only.
But the dude's got. I'll just go over to the dude's mom's and be like, "We're stealing the PS4." So there you go. We can make it work.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Brittany, you want to jump back in?
Yeah, I'm gonna jump back into questions now. So
do that.
Yeah, I'll try. So as a father in real life, how did your personal experience drive your performance playing a father in this film with stakes so much more heightened than they normally are?
I guess the process that I did, I just tried to take, because I modeled the relationship that he has with his daughter off of the relationship I have with my son.
Mm-hmm.
And then you don't try to think of the daughter like that's my son Koji, but you just take those emotions and apply them to the character that she's playing, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And with the stuff, like when shit goes bad, that takes a while to sort of build up for me. That's not something. I'm incredibly jealous of Shiri Appleby, the woman that plays my wife, and Kiara. They have this ability to just turn it on, you know? They can just emotionally break down at the drop of a hat and then go eat a taco. And it takes me a very long time to get there, not just that day, but I have to gear up for it weeks in advance and make myself emotionally fragile, because I've gotten really good at putting up emotional walls in my own life. So I have to actively break those down to be able to do it. That's the hardest part of it.
Right.
But once you break that down and you see the emotion coming out of them, I'm very selfish as an actor. I let you do the work for me. So if you're in pain and if you're on an emotional roller coaster, I'm right there with you. I basically go along for the ride you take me on. And they made it really easy for me, man. They, without any spoilers, there's one scene in particular that I watched them do that made it so easy for me to just lose it. Yeah. Those ladies are good.
That's awesome. So, kind of building on that, so artistic expression, playing an artist in the film, and having so much music involved as a critical part of that film too, we often consider artistic expression being, you know, something like the gateway to the soul, quote unquote, as it were, and in this film, quite literally so. As an actor, how do you relate to your character's intense artistic experiences throughout the film?
You know, I'm not a visual artist at all. I'm a visual creature for sure. But I don't have the ability to take what I'm, even what I imagine and put it up, or what I'm feeling and put it in a visual form. I'm envious of people that can do that. But I play music. Yeah, it's so, how did I do that? It's so amazing. I trigger emotions on us just on a two-dimensional visual. It is ridiculous. But I play music, and through, you know, the acting, the arts that I apply to that. I mean, it's similar in a sense, like what I had to do to get to that point, to, you know, break down emotionally. Like you take real experiences in your life, so that you become familiar with those emotions. And if you don't have, like, trauma, a lot of trauma in your life, for a movie like Devil's Candy, I sat up for hours at night watching Live Leaks. Do you guys know that site?
Mm-hmm.
Is that a yes?
Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah. So I got a little mini projector in my hotel room and playing silently to the Death Haven and Swans, was a projection of just the worst shit I could find on Live Leaks.
Wow. You can't unsee those kind of things.
Yeah, that would do it.
No, you can't. Yeah, you can't unsee them. Yeah. And I remembered how much of an impact it had on you, because when I was a kid, there were a couple. The first Faces of Death was stupid. Do you guys remember Faces of Death? Are you guys old enough to know that?
Yeah.
The first one was ridiculous. It was all fake. It was planned out. But then they discovered it was a popular idea, so they actually started putting together real footage. You know, it was like before Rotten.com. Do you guys remember that thing?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. And it was like the birth of, oh, wow, like true graphic violence really has an audience. But I remember the first time I saw those things, like Rotten.com, and later in the Faces of Death series when it was actual real people dying. Like, oh, yeah, I gotta dig into that shit, don't I?
I know at least I'm old enough. I think Brittany might be a little bit younger, but the video store culture of sneaking those movies out and hiding them from your parents, yeah, that was...
Yeah, they were always in that one little section.
Yeah.
And the first one was like... And most of the copies of Faces of Death were copies that the video store had doubled, you know? Like... obviously made on like a Radio Shack bought VHS, and somebody that knew them had it, so then they made a copy of it and threw it in a photocopied VCR box.
Right.
We used to love those things.
The viral video before the internet.
Right.
Yeah, you used to have to hunt it out, you know?
Like, yeah.
And that's... like taking it back to movie, we'll go on some tangents tonight. taking it back to the film industry, that's why Blair Witch was so popular. They did this, they did like a sort of like a grassroots under. They tried to present it as one of those.
Right.
And they had the VHS around for like a year before it ever came out in the theaters. And people would talk about it, and then you'd find a copy of it, and you'd watch it and be like, oh, this is a fucking movie, come on. But we talked about it for weeks before we could get our hands on a copy of it.
The Blair Witch did such a good job, too. I work in advertising, so I love talking about this kind of stuff, of using the mystery of the internet and the people's, you know, still trust in the platform before people realize that people were making up fake things. About building that whole backstory of the movie too, with, you know,
yeah,
profiles of the characters and little interviews, and like they made it seem so real that really heightened it before it was even released.
Yep. And we all didn't have internet.
Right.
So we take the word on the guy that did have it.
Yep.
And saw it. And if he fell for it, he told you it was real.
Right, yeah, exactly.
But if you didn't pay that $10.99 a week for AOL, you weren't watching it.
That's true, yeah. Yeah, that was crazy. But well done for the time. I mean, definitely wouldn't work.
Smart.
Now, yeah, totally.
No. They'll figure out a way. There's going to be some new way that's going to... I mean, they do it on YouTube. They did it... Remember that... there was that kid that had a massively popular... YouTube channel. I can't remember what the conflict was that they were going through, but it was all scripted. But they started a regular, like, weekly blog, and then the characters started confessing, like, horrible shit was going down, and she thought that, I think it was a kidnapping. And it got really popular, and then people discovered it was fake, and people got really mad.
Right, yeah, exactly. We get mad now. We're not like, oh, good one, guys.
Yeah.
The last time I remember being legitimately tricked by something, I think, was Cloverfield, when they were doing all the viral stuff for Cloverfield. I was like, oh, God, what is that thing falling behind those people on that roller coaster? And then, of course, it ended up being just a fake video for Cloverfield. But I think that was my last experience where... I saw
is that them. How they advertised it?
It's, yeah, they released a ton of fake videos that were meant to create the mythology of the monster.
Oh, rad.
And
that's rad.
Yeah, but it was also the kind of nail in the coffin of now, anytime I see something, I'm like, eh, I'm not buying this. This seems fake.
Right, and right, right.
Go ahead, Brittany.
I think a cure for wellness... As the advertising campaign started, before they did all the fake news stuff, was actually pretty interesting too, because I would get these like promoted tweets of like, have depression, cure it today, like much more like health related and like well-being related before it actually started coming out that it was film advertising. And I remember like, oh, that's cool. Oh shit, that's for a movie. And yeah, they did.
I still have to see that one too. That's out now, right?
Yep.
Yeah, last week.
I'm such a homebody. Listen to me, man. I gotta get out of the fucking suburbs.
That's what happens when you move to the suburbs of LA.
Yeah.
You never leave. No more traffic.
It's true, man. And you go and you sit in it and you get so mad. Like, I'm that old mad man in traffic. And if you drive down my street too fast, I am... Day. Oh, yeah, I'm fucking screaming. I chased a guy in the neighborhood. He was driving too fast. And I jumped in my car, and I fucking chased him. I was like, when he jumps out of his car, what are you fucking doing chasing me? You drove really fast in front of my house.
Slow down.
That's exactly what I said.
Yeah.
I didn't mention he's 17, and he's driving, too. But
doesn't matter.
I made it seem like he could be roller skating out front.
Right. On his skateboard ramp.
Yeah, yeah. I'm so old.
I love that you keep saying that. I think you're maybe like 5 years older than I am. So I can't decide.
It's a hard 5 years, man.
My husband works at SpaceX, and he reverse commutes back, and so he doesn't hit traffic until he hits LAX, and he's like, it's so horrible, man, and I'm like, you're driving towards the city away from people. Nobody wants to hear about it here.
You know what? You should lead with that whenever you're introducing people. you should just say your name, and then my husband works at SpaceX, because that's so rad.
Right? I know, he's outside, he's probably like, listening to us talk about him, but that's okay.
So dope. They're going to save humanity.
I know, it's crazy. Yeah, he comes back and he tells me all these crazy stories, and like, oh, Elon had this meeting today, and I'm like, oh, okay, and you know, oh, it's cool what they're talking about.
Iron Man, come on.
Yeah, when he interviewed there, Elon Musk just like walked by him. He was like, when NASA's recruiter, and he's like, oh, is Elon here today? And his recruiter's like, oh yeah, he's here like 3 or 4 days a week. And I was like, that man never sleeps.
It's amazing.
And I totally do that now. I'm like, hi, I'm Brittany. I work in advertising. My husband works at SpaceX, and I just shut up.
Yes.
Way more interesting.
That's good.
All right, I'm bringing it back to the questions now.
Yeah, okay, we'll go back. All right. We'll go back, so, my tangents.
So, throughout your career, you've had various roles in, like, other horror films and TV shows. What draws you to the genre and keeps you coming back?
You know, I guess I'll start with the material. I think that, you know, I think that the independent world of genre filmmaking is where the most interesting ideas are coming from. They are always trying to find new ways to tell, like, because let's face it, every story has been told already. You know, you're going to be pretty hard pressed to find a brand new story. It's just finding new ways to tell that same story again. And I think genre does it better than anybody. And it's hard work. It usually means you're going to go get dirty, and I like that. I like the people. I feel the most comfortable around the filmmakers that are attracted to that world. They're like me, my friends. You know, I'm of their kin. And so I feel the most comfortable around them. I feel like I can be myself as well. And that makes for a good work environment when you don't have to mind your P's and Q's.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's why we're all here, honestly.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's why you fall into certain circles. You find like folk, and sure, there's elements of whatever the circle is that attracted you in the first place, like music, you know? Yes, the sound of this particular type of music or this band attracts you, but it's also the people that are also attracted that keep you there. Like if metal was a whole bunch of just horrible douchebags, I probably wouldn't still enjoy going to the shows, but it's good people. So you keep coming back.
Now you just have little kids acting like ninjas in the mosh pit and just want to punch them in the face.
They acted like ninjas back in the day, too. They acted like epileptic ninjas, and by they, I mean me.
You did the ninja thing where you just swung your arms around wildly?
Yeah, the windmill. Yeah. I would do the one where you put your hand in front of your face and, like, throw your arm through the middle of it. So it's like you got, like, a face guard, too, you know?
Yes. I never feel bad for those kids when they get knocked over by the big dudes. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's part of the fun.
Yeah.
This is a true story. I went to a ton of metal shows as a teen in my college years just because that was what I did. The only one I've ever been injured at, and this was not metal, was a Thrice concert.
Thrice.
Yes. I got hurt at a Thrice concert because some kid moshed into me and knocked me into a speaker.
I just shook my head at you.
I know. I didn't want to be there. I still am just fascinated. That and, oh God, why am I blocking on his name? I had somebody try to start a fight with me at a, oh God, the British guy that sang that You're Beautiful song that was everywhere.
Oh, James Blunt.
Yes. I went to a James.
Which one?
James Blunt. Do you remember him?
No.
You're not missing anything. But I got dragged.
It's all pop music.
Yeah, it's the most easy listening, light classics kind of crap ever. And I had somebody pick a fight with me at a James Blunt concert and then spill beer all over.
He needs to listen to some metal and get a little aggression out, apparently.
It's entirely possible.
It's too calm.
That's always my complaint. I like James Blunt, but man, he's not metal enough.
I'm gonna get you a t-shirt that says that for your birthday.
I would wear it happily.
So, you've been working on a ton of TV projects lately, Grace and Frankie and Sneaky Pete, which is awesome, by the way. Are there any projects that you're working on that you're super excited about?
I did a movie last year that it premiered over at Fantastic Fest, but I don't think it's really, it's not really a horror movie. It's horrific, but not in the same sense that typical genre films are. Did you guys see Red, White, and Blue? Not the documentary, but the Simon Rumley, Amanda Fuller film from like 2008 or something like that.
No, I don't believe so.
See that?
No.
So Simon Rumley, he's a British director, and he likes to make some really heavy, heavy subject matter. Or take, in this instance, it's like subject matter that we all deal with and make it really heavy. It's doing the festival circuits right now. Amanda Fuller just slays in it. She's so good in it. And it's one of those where you're either going to love it and understand what Simon was trying to say, or you're going to fucking hate it and totally understand what Simon was trying to say.
So it's Fashionista? Is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, Fashionista. Yeah. Yeah, it's a beautiful movie, and Amanda, again, like, she went to the wall, so that thing, I'm sure, will be finding a home here soon. And then, Grace and Frankie comes and does another, you know, I think they release them on Mother's Day is when they usually do them, so we should have another one of those hitting the Netflix soon, and then just waiting for another. There was one I was going to do that it ended up falling apart, which was a bummer, but we were going to shoot it in North Dakota during the winter. And I saw the winter they had this year, and I was like, that's why we didn't make that movie.
that would do it.
Yeah, like special forces in the winter, all exterior. Yeah.
Frozen 2.
Yeah, that sounds brutal.
Yeah.
So we
for
have
$900 a week.
Good God. No, thank you.
Yeah.
So we have kind of like a multi-part last question. So we interviewed you a while ago. I can't even remember what it was now. But you said
it was for Cheap Thrills, wasn't it?
It was for Cheap Thrills. So it was a good bit ago.
It was a minute.
You said one of your favorite horror films was Phantasm.
Yes.
And Kat really wants to know what if you've seen Phantasm Ravager and if you did, what you thought of it.
I have not seen the new Phantasm. They made an updated one. Is that the case?
It's a sequel.
It's a sequel.
Yeah, okay. I put it on the other night. It's a straight sequel.
How is it?
I'm going to be political here and not say anything.
Copy. I hear you.
Yeah.
Look, the first Phantasm, like, one of the things I loved about it was its B-grade-ness, you know?
Right, and I love the first one as well, and I actually like the first sequel, but I don't know, you'd have to see it and form your own opinion.
I gotta check it out.
I don't want to put any thoughts in your head.
After Deathgasm first, and then this one.
That's fair.
I'll get on Deathgasm. I'll definitely get on Deathgasm.
So,
what other really great horror movies out? We just watched the Autopsy of Jane Doe the other night. It was all right. Like, there was the beginning of it was fucking terrifying.
I know one of our ladies saw it at Draft House in Austin, and she really liked it.
Yeah.
I've been dragging my feet.
It was creepy enough that we didn't watch it. We started watching it, and we stopped and went to bed and then finished it the next morning. It was creepy. It's fucked up.
Yeah, that's on my list. I got to go to a screening of Get Out on Tuesday, and highly recommend.
Rad.
Cannot recommend rad. Enough.
It's incredible. When is that coming out soon? That's soon, right?
Yeah, it starts tonight. They're doing, I think,
awesome
screenings tonight, and then it's officially out tomorrow. So, yeah, highly recommend that one.
Cool.
So what are some of your favorite films of the past 5 years that you can think of?
You know, I'd have to say, and I was just talking about it the other day, Babadook, if we're going to stay in this genre, Babadook was that within the last 5 years? I saw it within the last 5 years.
Yeah, I think it was 2014.
Yeah, I got to do like the nominating committee for SAG this year, so they sent almost every movie, and there were some really heavy ones, but there weren't a lot of straight thrillers that they sent out, but you know, I really liked, The Founder. Have you guys seen that? Totally different subject.
Is that the same McDonald's genre movie?
I haven't yet.
I know. I knew that it was out. I just have not had an opportunity to see it.
It's really good. It's weird because it doesn't really fall into straight horror or even really thriller, but L. Have you seen that? Is it German or French? She's nominated for it.
Oh, yeah, the Verhoeven movie. No, I am desperate to see that. I've just been waiting for it to come out since that's...
Because she's a fucking psychopath, man. straight up. The character she plays is, no doubt about it, psychopathic. And really enjoyable to watch. I dug that one a lot.
Yeah, that's
trying to think if there was one more. You gotta throw out Manchester by the Sea, you know? I actually really dug that movie.
Did
you see that?
Not yet. I'm behind on my Oscar movies. All I saw was La La Land and Hidden Figures, and then it's just been...
All right, so here's my little La La Land rant. You ready?
Please do.
I don't know.
Here's my La La Land rant. First of all, they nailed it. Beautiful. I love that director. Whiplash was one of my favorite films the year that it came out. So the dude's talented. And the two actors, what I'm going to say is got nothing to do against them because I think they both did their jobs. That being said, you do a movie about, like, this, I mean, you know, the struggles of Hollywood was a major part of the film. And it's this story about a girl who can't catch a break, moves away, and then literally just fucking stumbles on something because she followed her dream, you know? So why did they hire the two most bankable, biggest names in town right now? Why couldn't they actually find someone? Because then I would believe the movie. I'd be like, oh, it's possible. It's a true story. But by when they cast who they cast, they ruin any credibility behind the story they're trying to tell. That's my opinion.
I appreciate that.
Yeah, that was, I mean, I enjoyed the experience of watching it. I thought it was beautiful.
Yeah.
And I thought it was, especially as somebody that grew up on the musicals that it was paying homage to, I really appreciated it.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was,
yeah,
that was something that I thought too, besides the fact that, you know, I appreciate Ryan Gosling, but there were about 15 other people that could sing better and probably play the same part. But
And I for digress. Him, like, find a jazz musician that has never, you know, find a dude that can play, like, Hunt. Get off your ass and fucking cast a movie for once, Hollywood. Jesus Christ.
Right. Yeah, that was my... Even when I heard that they were making it, my first thought was, so Emma Thompson is a struggling actress? Okay.
Yeah.
Emma Stone.
Yeah.
Emma Stone, thank you.
One of them. Both, either way, really. Sharon Stone, Emma Watson...
Curse all these white people names.
Yeah. That being said, it's a good film. It's enjoyable. It'll get you.
That's my complaint, you know, about all Hollywood movie musicals. I'm a big musical theater fan, and I write about them a lot for The Honeys. Is that when they cast the movie versions of it, they cast, like, the biggest stars possible. And I'm like, there are 50 women in New York who would not need auto-tune that could play this exact role. And be amazing.
And the audience would appreciate it even more because we don't know them. So we're not taking our preconceived ideas into the theaters with us.
Yes.
You know? Like, you're going to go see La La Land and you're like, this is the hottest dude in the world. How about you go see it and you look at it and you're like, oh shit, this guy might be the hottest guy in the world. And you realize it there instead of being told before you even fucking go in.
Yeah. Greedy all of them.
That was an excellent rant. I appreciated that rant. All right.
There you go.
We will let you go, but I thank you so much for talking to us.
Yes, thank you.
Of course.
And
thank you guys.